That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
The exploration of outer space has long been considered one of the most exciting prospects humans have come across. The drive to explore and understand our closest celestial body has motivated space technology for decades.
Before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth.
In the 1960s, besides the United States and the Soviet Union, no nation had space programs sufficiently advanced to consider human moon landings. NASA landed 12 people on the moon between 1969 and 1972 as part of the Apollo project. Despite several subsequent policy initiatives by American presidents, no humans have landed on the moon in the decades since. Tyson believes that we are not going to the moon because humans are innate explorers, but because programs and goals were largely motivated by Cold War rivalry. According to Tyson, geopolitics is one of the strongest drivers why nations go into space.
In the 1960s, we went into space because we were at war, even though our memory tells us differently. We think of that time as, oh, we were explorers, we were discoverers. You look at the rhetoric from John Kennedy, the same speech where he said, let's put a man on the moon and return him safely to Earth. Go a few paragraphs earlier than that. And what you'll find is where he says, we need to show the world the path of freedom over the path of tyranny, because we just got bested by Yuri Gagarin having just gone into orbit 6 weeks before that speech. So one way we dream big is because we feel we are at risk of dying. Okay, that's the I don't want to die driver for spending money. No one wants that to be the prevailing reason for why you'd go into space. But there are others. The high road is, it is great to explore. But I'll take the low road if I have to. And the low road is, if you explore big and you pump the educational pipeline with students who are interested in taking up these fields because they see great things are happening for having done so, you transform your culture, and by doing so, you transform your economy. Innovations in science and technology have been the drivers of, they've been the engines of economic growth ever since the Industrial Revolution. Every nation who has embraced that fact since then has led the world.
In recent years, China, India, Japan, Russia, and the countries within the European Space Agency have all publicly speculated on future moon landings. With the US-China rivalry in the quest for global dominance, space may become, for the second time, a battleground for opposing ideologies. Since the beginning of the 21st century, China has been experiencing rapid economic growth, which led to higher investment into space programs and multiple major achievements in the following decades. According to the latest Space Industrial Base reports, China is now on track to outpace the United States as the leading space power by 2045. As society's dependence on technology increases, the incentive for one country to dominate over another will become increasingly important. China aims to send astronauts to the moon this decade, as well as establish a robotic research station there. Strategic rivalry with China's ambitious space program is helping drive NASA's effort to get back into space in a bigger way.
If we view China as a threat, you know all it takes to have China say, we want to build military bases on Mars. We'll be in Mars in 15 months. You know, again, you don't want war to be the driver, because we do have other drivers we can appeal to. It just takes a little longer to explain why that would work as a driver. So here's the problem. We live in an era now where a president makes a promise that now has to be kept by some president to be named later. Where is the continuity of that political inertia? So now, when are we going to land on Mars? Well, sometime, and we got to innovate some more technologies for that, sometime in the 2030s.
Under its Artemis mission, NASA plans to return on the moon and build a permanent outpost. This lunar base will allow NASA to mine the moon, extract precious minerals from asteroids, and eventually colonize Mars. Precious metals such as iron, nickel, and platinum are becoming more difficult to mine on Earth, in turn causing a worldwide shortage. This has people wondering whether the future of space exploration can offer a way to explore these materials that are now difficult to obtain. Science and technology experts believe that competition on this issue between various countries will only intensify. Some have even argued that a new space race is taking place. What this means for human life on Earth in the coming years and centuries is still yet to be seen, though some very important changes will take place as a result. NASA's human lunar exploration plans under Artemis call for return to the moon and establish sustainable exploration by the end of the decade. Working with US companies and international partners, they want to uncover new scientific discoveries and lay the foundation for private companies to build a lunar economy.
There's no more impactful force operating on the profitability of a business than what innovations you have that give you an advantage over anyone else. Your competitors, in this case, would be nations. Can we get back in the ring the way we were in the second half of the 20th century? Why didn't we continue? Why are we talking about this now? Why isn't it just history that we've got colonies on the moon, Mars, and beyond? So one can get excited that NASA has these new initiatives, but I'm remained a little disappointed that these initiatives were not in place decades ago. But better late than never, for sure. Plus, we have private enterprise that is becoming a partner, a major participating partner in this exercise. These are people who had those dreams. They're like my age, maybe a little younger. They had these dreams, and now they're fabulously wealthy. They say, if the government's not going to do it, we're going to do it.
Space competition is inevitable and offers huge gains to humanity. According to Tyson, although space exploration may seem like a frivolous endeavor, the benefits that come from it are very real. He argues that space science and exploration are the fuel to an innovative economy.
We created for ourselves an innovation culture. Not only do you benefit from the innovations of advancing a space frontier, if you advance a space frontier in a big way, writ large across the headlines, we're going to Mars, we're going to the backside of the moon, we're going to stop that asteroid. When you innovate, and it's writ large, you are inventing tomorrow. You have grand epic adventures that echo through the educational pipeline. We tell ourselves we live in a free country. If a smart person is interested in whatever they're interested in, they ought to be able to do that. Because when they do, everybody benefits. There's all this talk. Why get advances this roundabout way? Let's put money directly where the problem is. No, it doesn't work that way. Walk into a hospital with a ledger. Make a list of every machine in that hospital with an on-off switch. Every machine that is brought into the service of diagnosing the condition of your body without cutting you open. You will learn that every one of those machines is based on a principle of physics discovered by a physicist who had no interest in medicine. Right on back to x-rays themselves. Wilhelm Röntgen, the very first Nobel Prize in physics went to him. That Nobel Prize was not in physiology, it was in physics. Its physiological applications were manifest immediately, of course. I see my bones on the photographic plate. Take it over to the hospital. So you need medical technologists to create these machines, the cross-pollination of disciplines. The entire radiology department of a hospital is based on nuclear physics. The magnetic resonance imager, probably the most useful machine in the hospital today, is based on a principle called nuclear magnetic resonance. If you just fund the National Science Foundation, those same kids in the eighth grade class, have anyone ever stood up and said, when I grow up, I want to be an NSF researcher? I've never seen that, I'm sorry. But they've heard of NASA. So has the rest of the world.
Space exploration gives us a new perspective on our place in the universe, and with it, perhaps a better cosmic perspective. In his book, Astrophysics for People in a Hurry, Tyson wrote a chapter titled Reflections on the Cosmic Perspective, in which he said, imagine a world in which everyone, but especially people with power and influence, hold an expanded view of our place in the cosmos. With that perspective, our problems would shrink or never arise at all, and we could celebrate our earthly differences while shunning the behaviour of our predecessors who slaughtered each other because of them. Thanks for watching. Did you like this video? Then show your support by subscribing and ringing the bell to never miss videos like this.